Very good day to all of you. Today, I'm going to be speaking on a slightly sensitive topic. Sometimes it's not a very happy topic to talk about, because when you encounter people who have what we refer to in general as personality disorders, it can be very unsettling, it can be very disturbing. There's a lot of unpleasantness involved. But the fact remains that we have people around us who have these types of personality disorders. Sometimes we ourselves have to some extent, and we don't even realize that I have got this disorder, because of the simple fact that a personality disorder is a spectrum. It's a continuum. It is not that we can classify human beings into one who have no disorder, the others who have personality disorders. It's not as simple or as easy as that. For example, a person who is short-tempered. Everybody is short-tempered, sometimes selectively with some people, sometimes in general with everybody. But what is the extent to which I have a short temper? And how often do I do it? How long does it last? How much of an impact it has on the other person? All these factors determine whether it is an acceptable thing, I can get away with my short temper, or whether it is going to be difficult and I have this. Okay. Now, the main thing is, as I keep, repeating, that I am not a person in favor of these labels. This person is mentally retarded, that person has got schizophrenia, this person has got ADHD, all these type of things. I feel that in this continuum, you can't just, separate out people and say this is there. Now, you would have been hearing this word borderline personality disorder. Anytime a person is behaving badly, and if he's taken to a mental health professional, the person puts this rubber stamp and says he's got a borderline personality disorder. Without going into the technicalities of what they mean by that and all this, what I want us to understand is all personality disorders do not come under the realm of psychosis or major mental illnesses. If I have a major mental illness, if I've got schizophrenia, I've got bipolar disorder, I've got whatever, I've got Alzheimer's and all that. These are, disorders which require the constant therapy, treatment by professionals. If I have schizophrenia and I start developing hallucinations and delusions, I become suspicious of my near and dear, I do not interact with people, no amount of counseling, no amount of talking can help me unless and until I go on to medication. So I have to go to a psychiatrist, which is very difficult for a person who's got a mental disorder. And once I go there, I have to accept that the psychiatrist is saying that I have got this disease. And then I have to take medicines, not for one day, one week, or even one month. It could go on for months together. It could go on for years together. In some cases, it could be lifelong. Now, if I am told that I am diabetic and I have to take this medication for my blood sugar levels lifelong also, I accept it. But if I am told anything to do with the mind, it becomes so difficult, right? Anyway, that is not the topic that we are discussing today. Today we are discussing people who have, as I told you, personality disorders. Now, if you want a very oversimplistic definition, as I keep giving you all the time, if I am continuously reacting to others in ways that are unacceptable, firstly, and secondly, they cause disturbance, disruptions, and they disrupt relationships. If I have this sort of continuous reactions over a sufficient period of time, sometimes when we have a reaction to somebody, something we may have this, supposing I've suddenly lost my job, I can become short-tempered and irritable with everybody around me, including my family members, my friends, my neighbors, or whatever. But what happens over a period of time, it passes off. And then slowly I start getting back to normalcy and what I was earlier. I would not call that a personality disorder. If either it happens without provocation, or even if it happens with provocation, but given that period of time where we say, no, that time is the best healer. So I had got this, job loss or some major setback or relationship breakup or whatever. And because of that, I had, started getting into certain behavior patterns which were unacceptable. Then it's okay. But long after that provocation is gone, if I'm continuously going downhill or even continuing to respond, react to people in an unacceptable manner, then maybe, yes, you can put that label on me and say that it is a personality disorder. Now, here I want to make one thing very clear, that the definition of personality disorder, from a layman's point of view, I'm not speaking technical or clinical language at all. From a layman's perspective, disorders, personality disorders, are based on the culture. If you ask your grandparents and people before that, there were certain behavior patterns which, even though they were bad to people, but nobody protested. If there was a grandfather who was the head of the family, the eldest, and he kept shouting left, right, and center at everybody, disciplining everyone, putting down somebody, giving orders to somebody, in those days, it was not considered as anything bad. It was considered it was okay. Same thing with treatment of women. Men used to treat women in a way, and everybody used to accept that, yes, this is the way men treat women. You have to accept it. Children, for that matter, beating up children black and blue. It was so common. A teacher would beat up a child on the slightest pretext. And when the child comes home and the father comes to know, he would beat him up again. Saying, you must have done something wrong. That's why teacher beat you. And you are an insult to the family because you behaved that way. So I'm going to beat you up. Nobody even gave a thought in those good old days to these things like, is this person suffering from a disorder? Why is he continuously under some pretext or the other beating up his wife or beating up his child and all? Now, culturally, as we move on, certain things are acceptable and certain things are not acceptable. So keep that in mind when we tend to put these labels or even, go into the treatment and how we can deal with it. Then the other factor that comes in, which has been debated since a very long time, is, are personality disorders genetic or are they self-acquired? I don't have an answer. Research is still going on. But the sad part is, research on areas of mental health, we have no documentation of two generations back and before, no? So we can only go by hearsay. We can say, yes, this person's father and grandfather were both short-tempered and both behaved in a negative manner. So it may be genetic, but that's not enough. That's not conclusive evidence. It could be that the person has picked up, the person is mimicking first the grandfather, then the father. And because of upbringing, he has become like that. So it may or may not be genetic. That's an area which I'm not an expert on, so I will not comment till they come out with some conclusive, proof. But the fact remains that a lot of personality disorders start manifesting themselves somewhere around adolescence and then beyond. In some other cases, it is in young adulthood. And in some cases, it is when the person reaches the sunset years. Don't forget that. A person who may have been nice, pleasant, interacting well, getting along well, things like that. Children grow up, go away. This person retires. And over a period of time, you will see he starts getting very, very angry with his wife. Then it goes to his children. Then it goes to neighbors. Then it goes to the domestic help. Now, why is it that the person at 60, 70 years of age should change the personality and get into this extreme disorder? Again, as I said, I don't have an answer, but I can guess. that this person has suddenly lost his power, his, you know, vocation, the fact that he was needed by somebody, the fact that he was the breadwinner. When all that goes away, how does he take out his frustration? And however intelligent he is, however hardworking he is, however committed he has been to his work and his profession, nobody has taught him emotional intelligence. So he does not know how to manage it. Similarly, you may find some young people, very, very boisterous, very, very literally violent. And you start wondering, this person is on the threshold of adulthood. He's got his whole life ahead of him. Why is he behaving in such a destructive manner which can actually destroy his own life? He knows that. He knows what he is doing is causing problem to him. He was thrown out of college for misbehavior, or he has lost his job, or his partner has left him and gone away because he could not tolerate his extreme mood swings and all that. It's not that he is ignorant. He knows it. But why do we call it a disorder? Because he finds he cannot control it. And that is what we need to understand and accept. While there are certain medications, psychiatrists will prescribe something to at least symptomatically bring situation under control. But we, as non-medical people, we need to understand what can be done at the behavior level. Okay. So for that, you know, let me also explain to you that personality disorder is a very wide range of thing. There are so many types, you know, people talk about borderline, of course, then paranoid, schizoid, antisocial disorders, narcissistic, that you must be hearing very often these days, avoidant, dependent, and then another very common one, OCD, obsessive compulsive disorder. These are all in the category of the what we call as personality disorders. Experts and professionals generally put them into three different clusters. So I'd like to show you a small slide which Anis is putting up now about the three different cultures which people clusters which these people, you know, talk about when it comes to personality disorders. Let's say you can put them in cluster A, cluster B, cluster C. What is cluster A? Paranoid personality disorder. Scared of something, angry with somebody, keeping away from someone, being suspicious of someone. Schizoid personality disorder. Like they say, you know, a split personality type of thing, getting out of touch with reality and all those things. And schizotypical personality disorder. Let's not go too deep into the nomenclature and names and this and that, but I'm just sharing this with you. In another cluster, you have antisocial personality disorder. Person just does not want to talk to anybody. I've seen elders getting into that shell and then refusing to talk even to their own children or family members, and definitely not to outsiders. I have seen teenagers and youngsters also developing this antisocial personality disorder. Histrionic personality, you know, dramatics, making a big show as though he's on stage and he's doing some big performance, all these things. Narcissistic, of course. I need not tell you, you would be hearing this word every now and then. And of course, borderline personality disorder. What is there in the third cluster? Avoidant personality disorder. He wants to avoid anything and everything, including responsibility. He knows he has to pay the child's school fees, but he will avoid. He knows what the impact can be. The child may be thrown out of school, but still he avoids. And somebody else steps in, somebody takes care of it. He doesn't even feel bad that somebody else had to pay my child's school fees. Next time some responsibility comes up, again he behaves in the same manner. And as I was mentioning to you a little while back, obsessive compulsive personality disorder, OCD we call it, no? Being obsessed with certain things. It can even be, unfortunately, obsession with religion. there are people who get so obsessed and so paranoid about rituals. I have to do this in this manner at this time and in this way and this many times. Obsession. At the simplest level, it is obsession to keep washing your hands because you believe that there are germs all around you and you'll get into some infection or something like that. And then we have the dependent personality disorder, meaning to say the person becomes dependent on others. He does not want to, take responsibility for himself. He may be 20, maybe 40, maybe 60, but he will still expect somebody else to earn for him, somebody else to cook for him, somebody else to take care of all his needs, and he will be a dependent on them without feeling bad, without feeling guilty that he's making the other person bad. Okay. So this, I thought I'll just share with you that this is the type of clusters or the labels. But again, I repeat, that's not very important to us. Some people willingly behave badly. They are not suffering from a disorder. They want to show off. They want to impress. They want to control somebody. A person who's otherwise very normal, he has no such traits of a disorder. But if he is in charge of an office and of subordinates, he feels, unless I throw my weight around, they will not listen to me. Or at home, he feels, I have a wife and children. I have to prove to them that I am the master of the house. If I am soft, they will take advantage of me. So that's not his personality. That's not a disorder that he's suffering from. He does it purposely. And that you will find is often done by people selectively. That's how you can make out the difference. Only if the person consistently behaves in a way and he cannot control, even when he knows it is going to be harmful to him, that is when we refer to it as a disorder. And the parameter that I normally use is two things. One is it making the person dysfunctional? And secondly, is it causing harm to the relationships? If that is the thing, then you have to understand that. And mostly it affects the nearest and dearest people. So once more quickly, let's have a look at the types of personality disorders. This is another slide that we have over here, the next one. Yeah. As I mentioned to you just now, paranoid, antisocial, obsessive, compulsive, OCD, dependent is what I was talking to you last, avoidant, depressive disorder. The person, the slightest excuse, goes off into a depression and takes a long time to come out of it. Histrionic, theatrics, doing some tamasha, nautanki as they call it, and of course, narcissistic. So this completes the whole wheel of disorders. Again, I would like to remind you that we do not put them into these exact labels. Some of them are borderline this way, that way. Some have partly this and partly that. One very common thing about personality disorders, which my student Lena reminded me in the input that she gave, and I really appreciate her. Thank you very much, Lena, for that. Most people with personality disorders, they cross the line. They may get violent with their near and dear. They may be abusive. They may be, behaving in a manner which is unacceptable. As I told you, it could even be a dependent personality disorder where the person just refuses to take responsibility. He expects everybody to take care of all his needs. Even though he's able-bodied, he's educated, he can do things, but he will never do. Even a small thing like going to the shop and getting some provision for the house, he will not do. He will be dependent on others. But the fact is that most of the people with personality disorders do not cross the line of the law. The person may, for example, hit his wife or his child, but he will not hit in such a manner that tomorrow that case can go to the police and that evidence can stand in a court of law and he can be punished for it. He'll take those precautions. It's amazing how they do it. We think that they have gone berserk, they've gone out of control, but they know I can break the rules of how I need to behave with people, but I will not break the rules, which are the law of the land, which can get me into trouble. So do they really have control over themselves, or are they pretending? The answer is both yes and no. But the fact remains that if you see somebody with a strange, unpredictable behavior, most people with disorders are unpredictable. You don't know when he will get angry, what triggers him, when he will behave in a particular manner. Generally, most of them have some suspicion or distrust or whatever it is. Some of the people with personality disorders also are risk takers. They unnecessarily take risks. Then you have these extreme, you know, mood swings, sometimes even emotional outbursts when you are least expecting it. The person suddenly, and it's not just an anger outburst, it could be a crying outburst, taking up that victim role and saying, see, nobody cares for me, nobody loves me, I am suffering like this, I am the victim. Such an outburst can happen without any, you know, provocation, difficulty with different types of relationships and problems, be it in school or college, be it at workplace or whatever, you know, in the environment, there are going to be problems, and in relationship, there are problems. One more parameter which I have noticed very frequently in people with personality disorders is that they want instant gratification. They want immediately there and then to be, you know, taken care of. So let's have a look at one more slide I have for you, which is about the symptoms. Simple thing, if you go ahead. I've already told you, I'll just run you through quickly with this. Impulsive and risky behavior. Unstable self-perception. The person doesn't even understand, not self-aware. Difficult relationships, I mentioned that. Mood swings, I have mentioned. Cognitive impairment. Suddenly the person who is intelligent, aware, knows everything, withdraws as though he is mentally retarded or as though he is not understanding things. He neglects his hygiene at times. He will have volatile behavior. He'll have this paranoia, you know, that everybody is out to harm me and everybody is bad and stuff like that. Unfortunately, people with personality disorders are more prone to substance abuse. They seek outlets in smoking a cigarette or having a drink or even taking drugs. They may indulge at times, not very often, but they may possibly indulge in self-injury. We have to be aware of that, leading to suicidal behavior. Now comes the last part of the thing, and perhaps the most important part of the thing, that is, what do we do in terms of treatment? In all my years and years of dealing with different types of people, I have observed that there are some people who heal by themselves. You know that old proverb, time is the best healer. So I have come across, and that's what I reassure to the victim. When the victim says that for the rest of my life, do I have to suffer from this person? There are not too many, but there are some people. And again, as I told you, since we don't know what causes it, I don't know what, you know, would be the reason why they healed themselves. But the only thing that I can say is a calm and quiet environment, an atmosphere which is not toxic, which is not, you know, negative towards the person, possibly could lead to self-recovery, self-awareness, and change, if not 100%, whatever extent. But let us also be aware that many, many, many people with such disorders do need to go through the healing process. You can't just take it for granted that time will heal and at some point or the other, this person will become good. It's not possible to do that. So what is it that we need to do? First thing is, as I keep reminding, check out the upbringing and the childhood of the person. were some seeds laid into this person's mind? Did he have, for example, an abusive father who used to be violent with his mother? And the mother always used to say, you don't interfere. This is my husband. This is between me and him. No, but ma, you're getting beaten up. I don't want to see you beaten up. I love you very much. If you love me, you please go away from here. You allow me to deal with the person. Now, at an impressionable age, that can leave an impact. Is this what life is all about? Is a husband supposed to beat up his wives? And when these things start coming in, they start becoming. Now, I'm not condoning the action because his father used to beat up his mother, but I'm saying you can empathize better. You can understand better as to why he's doing it. And if you have that type of understanding, your ability to deal with the person also, you know, improves. Healing old trauma, resolving unresolved emotions which are left behind because my father used to beat me. I was ill-treated when I was a child. I was not allowed to study what I wanted to, and I was put down by somebody. I was compared to my siblings. If it has left a mark, then the emotional aspect of it, we need to work on healing that thing. And then comes the main, therapy or treatment or whatever you want to call it. There are medications available which work symptomatically. So as I said, if this person is violent, a good physician or psychiatrist can prescribe medicine which can bring down the extent or the damage that is caused by his violence. An avoidant personality disorder, person who just goes off into a shell and becomes asocial. Again, there are antidepressants and other medicines which qualified doctors can prescribe, which can reverse these type of symptoms which are happening. A person who's got anxiety, a person whose anxiety is to such a level that he's always thinking something bad will happen, this will happen, that will happen. So there are anti-anxiety medicines which can be prescribed. So if things are going bad, if things are, causing harm, etc., then it is recommended that you can take the person to a competent mental health professional and put him on medication. Unlike medication for major mental illnesses, this need not be taken lifelong or even for long periods of time. Once a person's lifestyle changes, once a person gets better control over himself and all that, he can be weaned off very easily, but only under the instructions of the doctor. Just because the symptoms have come under control and he's feeling better, do not allow the person to stop medication. The doctor will decide whether to reduce the dosage, whether to extend for some time, etc., and then you come down. Now, that is only when the symptoms go all out of control, so you need medication. Most other aspects of personality disorders have to be treated by what we call as psychotherapy. The best thing is psychotherapy, both formal as well as informal. Informal psychotherapy could be a friend or a neighbor or somebody who just calms down the person, who just does a little bit of hand-holding and says, don't worry, I'll take care of it. I'm there with you. Professional psychotherapy is what counselors, psychotherapy, psychologists give, where they systematically make the person aware. They may even use certain tools like Gestalt or REBT or CBT to bring about a change in the thinking and the personality of the person. But if left to itself, it can keep getting worse. So one needs to do something about it. If you find that anybody close to you or anybody known to you is either going into this type of personality disorders, or if you know somebody who's suffering because of a person with a personality disorder, don't neglect it. It can have very bad long-term effects. Okay. So with that, give me a minute. I'll take a quick break and I will be back. And Anis is here to make one or two quick announcements. By the time, I'll be with you.
Good afternoon, all. Just wanted to keep you updated quickly. So we'll not waste our time. We'll start with the activities what we have, which are happening. So again and again, we keep reminding, and again, today again, I'm telling that we do have free counseling, which happens at our place. So anybody who is interested, who would like to have the counseling sessions, which is totally confidential. So that free counseling is available at our academy, Monday to Saturday we work. We have our Helping Hand annual day happening in December. The celebrations are going to happen. So you can register at the earliest, contact our office numbers and give your names and be a part of our Helping Hand annual day celebrations. Coming to the next part is our month end camp. The registrations have already started. Post Diwali, the coming week, we will be having our month end camp, and the registrations will be closing very soon. So anybody interested there, your friends, your relatives, anybody there who would like to come and have, 2-3 days in a camp there, they're most welcome and they can register. Our office numbers are already put up there. So 88617-92260 and the other number 88614-21666. So these are our office numbers for any free counseling or any inquiries. It might be related to annual day celebrations, a month in camp, or it might be career counseling or any course related. You can contact us Monday to Saturday. So next session, we are going to have our question hour session. And sir is back here till we meet next week. Bye.
Yes, I'm back. In fact, I was just seeing the chat box and I see my wonderful student, Dr. Dharanish. Dr. Dharanish Prasad is a specialist in community medicine. I'm sure he deals with a lot of people. Dharanish, if based on whatever I have said, if you have something to contribute based on your continuous interaction with innumerable patients, he heads what they call as the primary health center, where people of all walks of life come over and he has to take responsibility for them. So I'm sure he has a lot to say. Let me know whether you'd like to put it on the chat box or you would even like to. Can he talk? Will he be able to know? Okay. So we don't have the provision for listening to Dharanish, but if you can put up one or two points on the chat box, I would really like to share with the others based on your experience. Okay. In the meanwhile, we start with Karthik, who says, can continuous stress on mind lead to personality disorder? Yes. Continuous stress on the mind does lead initially to some sort of a breakdown, some sort of a meltdown, as they say. So what happens is that supposing there is continuous stress, I have a loved one who's suffering from an incurable disease and is in pain, continuously suffering, and I am desperate. I have to look after the patient. I have to run around. I have to arrange finances. My stresses are constantly, going up. And at some point, I may go berserk. I may start lashing out at somebody. I may start getting very angry. I've known of people, for example, who have lost faith in God. They were very, very ardent, devotees and believers. But at one point, because of the stress and because of what has happened, they get. But the important point to remember, Karthik and all of you, is that if it is not a disorder, if it's only a reaction to the stressor, then slowly you will see the person coming back to normalcy. But if that is not happening, if the person remains at that level of the behavior which I mentioned to you, then yes, it is a disorder which has to be looked into. Surekha says, how can we encourage people with personality disorders to get into treatment and support them when they do? Supporting is, as you know, Surekha, very, very easy. And that's what we do. Whenever a person says that, yes, I'm willing to do something about it, I have, you know, lost my job, or I'm getting bad relationship with my near and dear, or I'm going through this, or I'm feeling guilty, or whatever it is, we can give a lot of support, we can. But the point that comes in is whether the person is willing to get into treatment. Now, as I mentioned, there are two levels of treatment. One is psychotherapy, the talking therapies. The other is medication. In most cases, particularly people who are not suffering from major mental disorders, they may or may not be willing to go to a psychiatrist and take medicine. The typical reaction, you must have heard this, is, am I mad to go to a psychiatrist? Am I insane that I have to take medicine for this? Yeah, I know I have a short temper, or I know that I'm avoiding this, but it happens. Everybody is like that. I'm not the only one. That way, if you see, everybody in the world will be mad. They make out such statements. So what I suggest is start with psychotherapy. In fact, when I see an indication of a person who says, I met somebody and he was saying, you go and meet a psychiatrist. Why should I meet a psychiatrist? I say, no, you don't need a psychiatrist. We will work on it. I'll help you and support you. You can work yourself. We can find some solution to whatever you are going through. So when I reassure that I'm not going to refer to the psychiatrist, the person starts becoming more cooperative. And then over a period of time, if you're not getting results, if the person is still frustrated, still short-tempered, still avoiding responsibility, then what I do is I slowly say, there's some simple medications, you know, which will ease off your pressure, which will reduce your stress, which will give you an opportunity to lead a better quality of life. I see you suffering so much because of this. Are you okay with the idea of just taking some medicine, at least for a short while? We can start off on that and see. So I put it in the most mildest possible manner. And if the person agrees, preferably with a caregiver who can be there to do handholding, go and see a mental health professional. And if some medication is prescribed, make sure that the person actually, you know, takes it. Give a lot of positive strokes when the person is behaving and is, you know, undergoing the treatment and the therapy. Keep encouraging the person and say, you do this and very soon, you know, you'll be able to make so much progress. You have so much untapped potential, all these type of things. Surekha also says, you should not expect to fix this person, and we should not expect an apology, because we cannot fix them and they will not apologize. Yes, in very few cases, Surekha, people have apologized. Despite the disorder and all that, when they think calmly, they do apologize and say, no, maybe what I'm doing is not okay. But they are very few. As you rightly said, most of them will not apologize. So why go into that? Why point out and say that, see, you have been bad to so-and-so, you have been misbehaving, you have been like this, you have been like that. That way you will never get the person to introspect and try to bring about a change. In fact, at times you need to be a little more than necessarily obliging, giving positive strokes more than what he actually deserves, so that he starts believing in you, he starts connecting to you, and then slowly you start getting the person onto your side. Yes, Dharnish, thank you very much. Dharnish says, I agree with most of the things discussed earlier. We get to see patients, people, and people around us with such personality traits. As you said, there is not much evidence on genetic transmission. Most of these traits need counseling and psychological support. See, this is coming from a highly qualified doctor. When it affects their lifestyle and relationships, they need to consult a psychiatrist. That's what I also said. Before that, it's very important and helpful if they seek help from their reliable ones, Banjara Academy, anybody like that. So in most of the cases of personality disorders, it is the non-medical part of it, the psychotherapy part of it, which plays the major role. And the therapist, the counselor, can also act as a conduit to refer the person. Sometimes if I find that the person, you know, gets put off by the word psychiatrist, I know some physicians who are also fairly competent in mental health. They are dealing with issues, people like Dr. Dharnish and Sumin. So sometimes what I do is I refer to a physician instead of referring to a psychiatrist. many physicians who have taken the trouble and who have been working in it are competent to prescribe these simple things like anti-anxiety, anti-depression, these, that, because this is not a psychotic issue where you have to be treated by a psychiatrist. Thanks for that. Shamla says, there's a person in our family seems to be normal most of the time. All of a sudden, without reason, he becomes silent or blames others. All peace will be taken away by this attitude. How should other family members behave in such a situation? See, if this has been happening on a regular basis, don't get, you know, complacent, because there are periods in between when he behaves nicely. That is not, you know, any indication that he is not suffering. He is suffering. What we need to do as a first step, I think, is to look for the triggers. If the last X days he was very calm, peaceful, he was doing things in a normal way, and today he is gone berserk, just check out whether today, yesterday, 2-3 days back, there could be a possible trigger. And see this, whether there's a pattern. Yes, yesterday he had an argument with somebody. Don't jump to conclusion that that is what triggered. Check out next time when he has an outburst, whether that day or previous day or whatever it is, he had an argument. So we know that this is what is leading. So once you understand the triggers, you can start working towards avoidance of those triggers. Even preparing the person by saying that, I know you're a sensitive person. I know when somebody blames you unnecessarily for something or somebody shouts at you, you get very disturbed. But because of that disturbance, you know, sometimes your behavior affects your near and dear. I know you don't mean it. That is how you take the person, you know, around. And when this thing happens, let the person calm down. And when he's in that phase, that X days when he is behaving very normally, that's the time to suggest to him that, can we see there might be some deep-rooted issues which are there, which you are carrying since a very long time. Can we talk to a counselor, a psychotherapist or somebody, and try to pull out whether there are those things which are buried deep inside and which keep coming out like this. And because of that, you know, you sometimes lose control or you become very upset, and then others get upset. That's the type of language to speak to them. Meena says, what happens when a person under medication stops to take medicine suddenly for a few weeks as he is suddenly upset and disturbed, and that person left home without informing anyone, alone and not traceable? Obviously, the first thing to do is to trace the person. We have the law, we have police, we have so many even social workers who do help in these matters. So the first priority obviously would be to locate and see that he is safe and he's in some place where he's safe. Even if he doesn't want to come home, would he be willing to go to a relative's house or to a shelter or whatever it is? So the first thing would be that. The second is, this is what I keep cautioning about, that if a person stops medication without consulting the doctor, it can have a very bad adverse effect. Even in simple things like antibiotics, doctors tell us that if the doctor has prescribed antibiotics for 5 days, in 2 days, if my temperature has come down and I'm feeling fit and fine, and if I stop that, I may be developing an immunity towards that antibiotic. Next time it may not work on me. A simple thing like, you know, an infection or an antibiotic. In this case, these are medicines which affect the central nervous system. So you have to be extremely careful. The moment you find that he has stopped taking the medicine, do something about it. Even for major mental illnesses nowadays, we have certain IV injections which have long-lasting effects. So where a person is supposed to take a pill every day, if he doesn't take it, in some extreme cases, they are given IV injection, which has an effect for 15 days, 30 days, whatever it is. So even that is now available to us, which was not there earlier. Arun says, some of them do not admit they have this disorder. Many of them, Arun, especially narcissistic personality disorder, how to handle them. The first step that I would do is to pamper their ego. I tell them, yes, if you say you don't have a narcissistic problem or you don't have a personality disorder, I'm sure as a mature and educated person, you must be knowing yourself better than I do. So I'll take your word for it. But what is happening in your life? Are there relationship issues? Are there work-related issues? Are there management of emotions issues because of which you are suffering? I don't want you to suffer. So forget about all those labels, narcissistic personality disorder, all that. Can we do something about the issues that you are going through so that you feel better? And in turn, your near and dear people around you, they also feel better. That's how you need to take them forward. But in extreme cases, if they just do not respond, then the victims have to see what is the alternative left. Surekha says it is important to set boundaries because an ounce of prevention is better than a pound of cure. Absolutely right. Surekha, I always keep telling in the area of mental health, somehow we have not understood that prevention is better than cure. In physical ailments, we do that. You have a child at home who's got a cold or cough, you immediately go to the doctor or start giving some medicine or something like that. But when it comes to mental health issues, many of us are negligent. Let's spread the word around what Surekha said just now, that you know, prevention is better than cure. Pankaj says, agree with you totally. Shukriya. Thank you. Yes, Dr. Dhani says, they need good psychological support and positive strokes. Yes, that's very important. They need good support to stay positive in life. Normally, if I have a personality disorder and I'm behaving in a manner which is unacceptable, I'm also getting criticism. People are pointing out to me. People are putting me down. People are avoiding me. People are being curt with me. And that aggravates the symptoms. So as Dr. Dharnish said just now, if you give them psychological support, you give them positive strokes, genuine positive strokes, not appreciating their anger or things which they are doing which are bad, but appreciating other aspects of their behavior, which may be good. And that is why the more positive they stay in life, the better are the chances that they will be able to lead near to normal life. Surekha says, we need to understand that a person with a personality disorder is sick. Yes. We don't need to waste our energy making them healthy. How can we strengthen the relationship with ourselves so that we stay healthy when we have to coexist with such people? There are so many ways by which we can do it, but you have to select what is right for you. Some people do things like meditation, yoga, mindfulness, prayers, chanting. Some people do something like physical activity, which helps them to relieve. Some people go for various types of things. Some people like music or something like that, which keeps them soothed. And the most important is counseling, psychotherapy. So if I am a victim of a person with a disorder and I still have to interact or live with that person, I need counseling. I need to have some sort of handholding which will strengthen me to deal with this difficult situation for which, at least in the short run, there doesn't seem to be any cure. Raji says, I have an aunt who is very negative and keeps repeating what she says. That's another aspect of people like these, you know. They become repetitive. They keep on saying the same negative thing all the time. Any negative things happening to someone, she thinks it will happen to her. Paranoia. What kind of disorder is this? How do we handle? This is what we refer to as the paranoia, paranoid personalities, that the world is going to go down. Something will happen here. Something will happen there. I know of people like that. Something happens in some corner of the world and they connect and they say, see what is happening. I need to be careful. It can happen to me. Some amount of acceptance first and then rationalization. By saying, yes, can we take some precautions? Can we do something about it? How are you preventing yourself? Or I am there for you. If anything like this is under threat, please get in touch with me. I will take care of you, or I'll try to guide you how to go about it. So slowly, 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 we can overcome this type of paranoia to some extent, at least, if not complete. Meena says, there is a missing person I'm aware of with some mental disorder. My question to you, Ali, is will they ever come back home on their own? They may, but the chances are not very high. When a person has, you know, lost touch with reality, he also loses touch with the basic cognitive functions of this is my home, this is my path to go home, this is my address, this is how I can reach home. If that cognitive ability is being subdued, then even if he wants to, he says, I'm hungry, I have to get fresh clothes, it is raining, I want to go under a shelter, but where is home? They lose track. But like I said, there are ways and means, starting with the police and various NGOs and all that, who do help in these situations. If you can tell them where the person was, what is he likely to be doing, what does he look like and all that. There are people who do some sort of hunting around and find out. The only problem is if the person has gone off. There are occasions where the person just, let's say, get into a train and moves off some 500 kilometers somewhere. And there, nobody knows him. He doesn't even speak the local language properly. Those are the cases which become very difficult. Surekha says, sometimes people put up with a partner who is creating constant tension because they feel that a known devil is better than an unknown one. Yes, Surekha, I always keep repeating that we have these GIWs, the great Indian woman, whose tolerance capacity, whose ability to sustain, whose ability to make sacrifices is phenomenal. When I look at these people, how they go on and on, they live the rest of their life, you know, tolerating and sometimes even accepting that, yes, this is the known devil and it is better that I stay with this person. I suffer, I don't mind, but for the peace of the home or for the well-being of the family, or if there are children involved, they do that. What I would like to tell all of you is, please reach out to such people. Give them as much emotional support as you can. Give them as much distraction as you can. Give them some activities where their mind can look into other things which are more, you know, peaceful and which are better and things like that. Such people really need help. If there is a constant, you know, provocation or attack by somebody with a personality disorder and this person cannot leave home or cannot leave that person, sometimes they can, but they don't want to. They say he can't take care of himself. He will not be able to look after himself. So if I leave him and go, anything can happen. He may fall down, he may fall sick, he may do anything, he may harm himself. So therefore, I have to look after him. Now that, as I said, is an amazing, courageous sacrifice which a lot of people make. And it's not just women. I know men also who make these type of sacrifices often. But the bottom line is that we should provide help, support, to whatever extent we can to such people. The moment you identify that there is a person who is a victim, that to a victim of constant abuse because of the disorders or misbehavior of the other person, please reach out as much as possible and keep giving support on a continuous basis. Maybe even make a team, involve one or two other close friends or relatives who can take turns, because you may not be there all the time. You may not be able to do too much. If there are two, three people who are doing it, you can divide the work. You can even share what the person responds to and what the person does not respond to, what would be good for them. This has been my experience. Based on that, you can go ahead and work on these things. It is possible. This is part of life. In life, 5,000 years back and today, despite all technology, despite all the artificial intelligence, human behavior remains the same. People do have disorders, people who do behave in an unacceptable way. And there are victims who suffer because of this on a continuous basis. Let's do our little bit. We cannot change the whole world and we cannot, you know, rescue people or anything like that. But anything that you do, just a word of, you know, understanding and empathy and compassion to that person can strengthen that person to deal with the difficult situations. And sometimes it can also help the person with the disorder to start thinking, at least, that maybe I should bring about a change. Keeping that in mind, let me wind up the session for today. And next week, I'm going to be speaking to you from a place which has wonderful memories for me. It is called Manthan. So I'm going to be in the Manthan camp, but I'm not going to neglect this Saturday session. I'm going to be with you at 2 o'clock with the topic using happy memories to enrich your life. However bad life has treated us, we all have some happy memories. Sometimes we tend to neglect them. And very often when things are going bad and we have negative things to face, we start pushing aside the happy memories and we only start thinking of the negative ones. Just recalling, reliving those happy memories can go a long way in making your life better. Think about it. Give me any inputs that you would like to give me. And please join us on Saturday, 18th of November at 2 o'clock. I will be there amidst nature in the beautiful campus of Manthan. You can come and join us also if you feel like coming over and spending some time there. Or you could sit at home and interact and listen like we always do every Saturday. So see you. Thank you very much. And bye-bye.